extends up to Vikarabad. So this is very typical, actually, the road laying also. So that's why we don't see any villages on either side of the road. So we see villages mostly along the banks of these two streams, because agriculture requires water, and these are the low-lying areas. And here we could next area. So here you could see it's like an egg-shaped basin. We could see there very nicely all these dendritic patterns of the streams, the green parts, and leading to these two reservoirs. So, but here I want to show you a trend. This satellite imagery was taken in 1984, and this satellite imagery was taken in 2003. But most important thing is, please observe certain points here. I'll show with the color pen also. See, this particular area, you can observe this particular area. I'm showing the same area here, like this. So overall, the dendritic patterns of which are more visible or prominent, you could see here, you could see a green the pattern here. This is where the water was normally flowing. But you could see here, it has disappeared. It means there is lots of real estate interference in the drainage of this area. And almost all the existing natural drainage system or the catchment area has been completely altered. It is like as though somebody had made it with a, like it is like the duster used on a blackboard and wiped out the things. So that clarity and resolution is also missing, because that whole drainage got impacted. We know there are so many these farmhouses, or many estates have come up in this area, and they have occupied, and they have occupied even the Nala areas. The first order streams got impacted very much. You could see after Chevella, at least some dendritic patterns are seen where agriculture is the main thing. But here you could see almost all everything is marred. So this is very, very important. So we could collect all the imageries right from 1984 or beyond, and even the latest. So in the last 20, 30 years, what happened, we could know. So here, again, I was going through the... హలో
చూస్తున్నా మెన్షన్ చేయలే చేస్తాను
ఓకే సో హియర్ ద టెరెన్ ఐ వాజ్ సీయింగ్ హౌ స్టీప్ దిస్ టెరెన్ ఈజ్ సో ఐ హడ్ టేకన్ అలాంగ్ దిస్ మూసీ రివర్ దెన్ హీట్ ఈస్ ఫ్రమ్ 660 మీటర్స్ అబోవ్ మీన్ సీ లెవెల్ టు 540 మీటర్స్ సో దిస్ హోల్ డిస్టెన్స్ విల్ బి అరౌండ్ ఇఫ్ యూ సీ around 60-70 kilometers. So the rate of fall is like around maybe about 10-15 meters. So the rivers are not so fast flowing, especially these two, Musi and Isi. They are gently flowing, but earlier there used to be lots of sand deposited all along the streams. Now almost all that sand mining is going on everywhere, and here so. So almost all it appears bone dry. So the as a child myself had any time, even in the summer, what we say chalimalu, it's a kind of spring. The subsurface flow of water was there in these rivers, and we could drink anywhere. And all the animals had some water, and so that was the system. Even I have seen the moats. Moat is a traditional the bullock cart bucket kind of thing where water is drawn. So that was the traditional system. So there were kind of wells within the river bed, and it was sustainable. Now, if you see this whole thing, again, this is the trend, similar, the gradient of these rivers or the slope is similar. So groundwater in this whole area, what is happening? Especially if you see the Vikarabad area. So if you see this, minimum, maximum, and the state average water level. So it is the deep bore wells are existing here, and only comparable other things are like Nalgonda, which is having even deeper bore well, groundwater is depleting very fast. And here again, we could see this, the groundwater levels is far below, especially you can see the earlier map of Rangareddy, United Rangareddy. So the red color area means it is deeper. Again, we have the geologically, the two kinds of rocks, the basalts, they end near Chevella, so all the way. So we have red soils or black cotton soils in the western part of Chevella or up to Chevella. And again, the soils will change towards Hyderabad, but ultimately the base is peninsular gneiss. So here, the aquifers are not many, and very deep aquifers are there. And so this groundwater is not very much available here in this whole area. So exploitation is going on rampant, and the chances of groundwater is also less. So here, Pulmadi village in Vikarabad, Mandal. So this is one of the case study. Dug 120 bore wells and 1.3 crores has been spent, and all of them have failed. This is happened in 2016, a kind of which appeared in a newspaper, an article. So how the farmers are investing and how they are exploiting the water. So this is one of the reason for not availability of the water or reaching this water to this reservoirs. If we have 111 GO, it is basically to protect these water bodies, because these were the only resource which sustained the Hyderabad, apart from preventing the floods that happened in Hyderabad. And these are the beautiful reservoirs, and now they are no more considered as a resource. So this water availability or even pollution of this area, why the industries are not allowed in the catchment area. Now recently some industries are coming up. Again, that's a challenge. Why they are allowing these industries or the construction and all that need to be looked at. So here again, how the water table is falling in this area. So these mandals mainly falling, some of the mandals with very high rate of fall is including are the districts is the Vikarabad also. So irrigation along the river, this is one more challenge. So even this picture, particular picture was taken in the summer. This is March 8th. So we could see all along Puddutur village is in the that Musi area. So you could see this greenery, dark green areas are the irrigated area. Even in the March, midsummer, if people are irrigating, so much means all the water resources is fed through this river only. So we could understand, of course, this is a very agriculturally, if you go to Vantunian agriculture zone areas, this is a very high intensive for vegetables and the perishable goods like greens and many other things that come up and they serve the Hyderabad city also. So by default, the farmers are very intensively involved in agriculture. So the impact of this groundwater extraction and all that we could see. Similarly, in Gundal village, this is my own native village, you could see all along how intensive agriculture is going on in the month of March. And again, Regad Mamidipalli, this is one of the villages I'm very much familiar, because this is my grandmother's village. So again, you could see here.
Saivaskar, excuse me. Yeah. You have 15 minutes time for you. I'm sorry, I forgot, I didn't tell you.
Okay,
it's, you have 7 to 8 minutes more left for you. Thank you.
I'm closing very soon. So you could see the again one more important aspect is urbanization. So here you could see 2003 how the Chevella appeared. There are very few houses here built and almost all vacant. But now by 2012 you could see the residential houses have come up, and by 2015 you could see even more development, and 2019 you could see the maximum development. So similarly around Gandipet also in 2003 there is almost all nothing much development around. I am looking not in the downstream of Gandipet, but in the upstream areas. Please look in the western part or northern or southern part of Gandipet dam. So here you could see again 2009 some urbanization happened, and 2012. So slowly by 2019, you could see many things have come up. The structures have come up here around Kandipet, and so much alteration is there in the catchment area. And this is the latest picture, very recent picture. So 6th month. So Usman Sagar never appeared like this in this month. Otherwise, if we compare the historic the pictures of the same lake, so they are available. We could see every year during the same period what happened. Similarly, Himayat Sagar 2019, how it is, and 2020. So ultimately, this whole area urbanization is taking place. The Chilpur, Moinabad, Ajijnagar, and all that real estate is going very fast, and it's a very in spite of Tripulu NGO, and there is nobody stopping it. This construction or the selling of plots. And Moinabad area, you could see again in 2003 there is very little development. And 2015, you could see already, and by 2020, almost all we could see completely covered by this. All these white color areas define the urban areas. So most important aspects which I want to sum up to say is, urbanization is one of the reasons that is for water and the catchment area getting affected. Second thing is intensive agriculture that is happening, and watershed activities have also taken place in the last 20, 30 years, slowly every year. And local geology and aquifers, which I said, and green coverage and forests, that is also got affected because we have a beautiful savanna kind of landscape in the Mudimal Kancha, and the health of that forest and all that is very much need to be taken care, including Vikarabad forest, Anantagiri hills, and downstream also near this Parigi and all that. And the naval this thing radar is also coming up there. That forest also need to be taken care. So all this will help in the recharge of this area, and also support. And most importantly, climate change, because with climate change we have more incessant and sudden downpours of rainfall, and there is a shift in season also, and also the temperature will be higher, and that is the global warming happening everywhere. So evapotranspiration rates will be higher, the crop requirement of water will be higher. So all these things together is affecting the total geography or the catchment area of this Kandipet as well as the Musi river. So now we could see the Musi as when the water reached near Puranapul area, and also the plans that are happening around Musi, like the construction of roads and all these plans are going on. And we don't know how the Musi will be. I have not touched much about the Musi. I think other speakers will share more about. I only touched the catchment area aspects, especially in the context of rainfall and partly on the climate change aspects. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sai Bhaskar. As you said that other speakers need to cover the more on Musi, and actually we also need to, somebody has to discuss more about the GO 611, GO number 611 also, because that is not a strict implementation of the GO is making causing several problems. As you mentioned that, rulers, whoever comes into the power, will mention that we took the, the Hyderabad city to, global level, etc. and all. But nobody bothered about the kind of development and the kind of, the development of the city or expansion of the city. There is no, rules or regulations. There is nothing has been taken, considered. Like, for example, the catchment area of those major tanks, and also the catchment area of the Musi River, and also whatever several technical and scientific things like what the wind direction and the water issues, drainage issues, etc. So all those things has to be considered these days if the city is developing, and unnecessarily it is because of that globalization, the urbanization and all of a sudden, and the several industrialization also has took place, and combination of industrialization and the urbanization caused all these problems. So we also need to remember that we have a huge burden on our shoulders, not just the things which we are discussing. If you see that the area in Telangana, this is the river which starts in Telangana and ends in Telangana. This is only the river. And almost about 30 to 35% of Telangana population is affecting because of this Musi. And the impact of this sudden growth of the Hyderabad city and in zigzag fashion. And also the population is about the 30% of the Telangana population is affecting directly or indirectly. So we need to take that. That shows that how serious the problem is. Not just we are only, you know, talking about the environment as everybody is talking, but the Hyderabad city is really, really on the edge of the more danger that, and our rulers are waiting major disaster to happen like corona and all. If corona kind of virus problem comes due to the mosquitoes, that if some virus transmittance through the mosquitoes, then half of the city will be gone. So thank you again for Sai Bhaskar. Now I request Subbarao Garu. So he's expert in the groundwater and rainwater and also the environmental issues, especially, and is a very, very veteran and fighting all the issues, kind of environmental issues which are facing not only the state or central level, national level, or even international level. Presently, he is a convener for the convergence for the sustainability. I request Subbarao Garu to present his arguments.
Thank you, Dr. Indrasen Reddy Garu. Hope I am audible.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, you are audible.
Oh, thank you.
Louder.
Yeah, okay. See, actually, I'm happy that, you know, the group could come back and, you know, discuss on the twin reservoirs and the Musi. This year happens to be the 100th year of twin reservoirs. It was 1908, the floods came. 1912, the work for controlling the flood started, which subsequently completed and commissioned in 1920. The entire story, can I share the screen, please? I have a PPT, a small PPT.
Yeah, you can share.
I'm not getting
can you?
So there's a share screen option, sir. You're the co-host now. You can see the
I'm
share
not
screen
able option. To see that, actually. Okay. One second. Let me check. Screen share. Okay. Okay. Can you see?
Yes, sir. It is
clear. Yeah.
This was the incident of 1908 floods. And this is the beyond the Purana pool, actually. This was the officer's camps right on the banks of Musi River.
Yes, light show better.
Screen share lo vachindi kada?
మీ కింద
స్లైడ్ షో అని ఉంది కదా
రైట్ బాటన్ రైట్ సబ్
రైట్ బాటన్ షేర్ ది స్క్రీన్ నాట్
మీరు అది విండో వచ్చినాక స్లైడ్ షో వస్తుంది సేమ్ మన పిపిటిలో.
అది ఆటోమేటిక్ వచ్చేయాలి కదా. హోప్ యు కుడ్ సీ.
లేదు రాదు, మీరు మీకు ఆ విండో చూపెడతారు. ఇప్పుడు ఆ కింద స్లైడ్ షో అది ఉంటుంది కదా, కింద కనపడుతుంది.
అవునవును.
కర్సర్ పెట్టండి, స్లైడ్ షో అని ఉంటుంది అది క్లిక్ చేయండి.
కెన్ యూ? హలో.
యా
దిస్ వాజ్ ద 1908 ఫ్లడ్స్ విచ్ ట్రిగర్డ్ ఆఫ్ ద జెనిసిస్ ఆఫ్ ట్విన్ రిజర్వాయర్స్ అండ్ హిస్టారికల్లీ దిస్ ఈస్ ద ట్రీ, టామరిన్ ట్రీ ఇన్ ఉస్మానియా జనరల్ హాస్పిటల్ విచ్ సేవ్డ్ ది లైఫ్స్ ఆఫ్ 150 పీపుల్ and every year the old city people gather here to celebrate this. This is the 1920 Gandipet or the Usman saga, and simultaneously two reservoirs were filled. The one is the Himayat Sagar, the other one is the, this is the location map of Usman Sagar and Himayat Sagar with respect to the Hussain Sagar. Both are located on the east of Hyderabad. And most interestingly, there are certain issues which were not discussed in the public domains. Usman Sagar, Himayat Sagar, primarily constructed to control the floods to the Hyderabad city, and simultaneously were also designed to supply drinking water to then city, which was catering something like Usman Sagar was 3.9 TMC and Himayat Sagar was 2.9 TMC, and which was catering to the needs of the city till 1980s. But interesting point is the population which it was catering still continues to get the water. Then why everybody is talking that Usman Sagar and Himayat Sagar have become, you know, defunct? We need to look into it. The most important thing, I am asked to make a presentation on the watersheds. This is the watershed of the Usman Sagar. You have Usman Sagar has much larger watershed, something like 1400 square kilometers, but whereas the Himayat Sagar has lesser watershed or the catchment area, which is around 700 and odd square kilometers. But interestingly, the land use pattern in these two catchments and combinedly, more than 70% was agriculture. And they claim that it is only 2 to 2.5 forest areas. But I feel the land use data is still erroneous. And recently, NGRI carried out studies in 2003. Still, they say forest areas and the land use areas, 3, and agriculture areas, something like 68.21%. But the thing is, what happens to the rest of the area? Under what classification they are categorized? And how they are being taken care of? This is most important. And these reservoirs were constructed to get full reservoir levels once in 3 years only. All the tanks in Telangana and most of them in southern India, they do not get filled up in one monsoon. This point has to be noted, and it must be sensitized and, you know, educated to the people. So every time we look into our monsoon and say, hey, Gandipet is not getting full, or Himayat Sagar, no, it will not get full. These reservoirs were created, designed to receive 3 consecutive monsoon rainfalls to get maximum water levels here. It has created as a drought mitigation structures also, all the tanks in the Telangana. So without knowing this, the collector, the administrators, policy makers, everybody looks into when the lake gets dried up so that they can give the pattas or encroach the lands. It is very much clear. One can look into the Nizam's Farmana, and it has very beautiful watershed management practices. It was clearly stated that no new water conservation structures to be promoted in these catchment areas. Of course, then there is no acute groundwater or deep groundwater exploitation in those days. That was the situation. And interestingly, as my friend Dr. Sai Bhaskar pointed out, Chalamalu, the springs, the natural springs right from Vikarabad to Damegudam to Gandipet, they were existing here, and they still continue to exist in Damegudam and Vikarabad zone. But unfortunately, the springs in the catchments of Himayat Sagar and Usman Sagar, they got dried up. Then what making, these are the things we need to look into it. 87. You see, interestingly, from 85 to 2003 or so, it got only 7 times full. I have collected 50 years of rainfall for these catchments, and also analyzing the entire patterns of the rainfall. So we need to look into the hydrological pattern, the functional aspects of the watershed, how active and healthy the watershed is. You see, it is not the reservoirs. Reservoirs are the reflection of the watershed's health. We have to look into the watersheds. The watersheds are, watershed is a geographical area. This I just kept for the new, aspirants who are getting into this particular subject, And this is what the watershed is, and the entire rainwater collected will discharge through a single outlet. That is Usman Sagar or Himayat Sagar, finally goes to Musi. So we should understand what is the watershed is. And the watershed of Himayat Sagar, Usman Sagar, which is around 2000 square kilometers, is part of Musi River Basin. Musi has 12,000 and odd square kilometers of geographical area. It's basin wise. And as my friend pointing out, today the Musi basin, more than 50%, it is 60% urbanized. Hyderabad Metro Development Authority possesses 6,600 square kilometers of area already urbanized. Planned for future urbanization, 6,600. Now you look into the other urbanized areas, Nalgonda, Chityala, Suryapet, there are several others. This watershed and the basin is so blessed, one can find the natural springs around Nalgonda also. So hydrogeologically, this area, watershed basin and the river basin is very unique, and has the springs, groundwater, and base flows. One always should understand three terms. One is the surface flow, which we see. The other one is the groundwater. We can't see, but when we pump out, we can see. Between the groundwater and the surface water, groundwater, and then the base flows. Base flows are the water that is subsurface. When it gets saturated, it overflows to the surface as springs and starts feeding into the reservoir. Today, the highly biodiversified watershed of Usman Sagar, Himayat Sagar, and the basin has undergone metamorphic changes. Let us look into it. Gandipet water and Miryalam tank water was known as miracle water. It was sweet during my childhood. It tastes changed. Everybody used to say, there is a saying in Hyderabad, Gandipet ka pani piyo. So, blah, blah, it goes, but it's true. It could be because of the high density herbal floral plantation, natural plantation in these hills of Anantagiri and Damigudu. That might be flowing into these reservoirs. Nobody cared to study this. Only Usmania University, they came out with list of herbal and medicinal plant species. And what is the impact on the water resources? Nobody bothered about it. Why not we do this? This is a big gap. And similarly, this area has salubrious and healthy wind. You see, the very purpose and the reason for establishing the TB sanatorium in Anantagiri was the reason. So today we are not appreciating regarding respecting the biodiversity watershed of this, and we are not looking into the functional efficiency of this watershed to contribute to the hydrological sustainability. Now the point is, everybody is happy that government will allow on a larger scale the real estate, and thanks to Kaleshwaram, everywhere we can take Kaleshwaram water and fill the reservoirs. I tell you, we are going to repeat the disaster of Warangal to Hyderabad. All the lakes around the Warangal were filled from borrowed waters, and suddenly heavy rains came, entire thing was a disaster. We are undermining the hydrological sustainability of the watersheds. We are not understanding this. I request Dr. Indrasena Reddy, sir, please look into the watershed management and governance in the US federal system. You have beautiful management practices. How we do that? Can we transfer those? Can we educate people on that? We need to look into these gaps. Otherwise, we are undermining the sustainability factors of functional efficiency of the watersheds. This is the problem today. And will you look into it? You know, it has three different geological formations. You have the gneisses, you have the basalt, you have the laterite soils. And the proportion varies from the Usman Sagar to the Himayat Sagar reservoirs. So we need to look into it. And the northeast watershed from Anantagiri Hills, it is all tectonically disturbed area. Because of this diversity and the basaltic and gneisses formation and conglomerations, it gave very good, healthy, potential, productive agriculture soils. That was the reason down the lane, the ECRISAT was established in 1960s. We are not looking into the potential of these natural resources. We are only looking to the physical structure and revenue that we get from it. So we should also look in the conformity zone of gneisses versus the basalt. Both exist in the both reservoirs. What is the hydrological behavior at this? Even NGRI did not come out with any study of this. So we need to look into these gaps and start looking into how we can take it. So the problem, the undermining the functional efficiency started in mid-second half of 1980s when TDP came into the power. The then Chief Minister Sri N.T. Rama Rao Garu, for his farmhouse, he was started pumping from reservoirs. Nobody objected that. Then came numerous developments. Today, this watershed has 70 colleges, medical colleges, engineering colleges, pharma colleges, everything. Drawing waters from the groundwater, over withdrawal of the groundwater, and you have 70 colleges, educational academic institutions, more than 35 mineral bottle companies. PCB says they're orange. They doesn't pollute, but they undermine the operational efficiency of my watershed. We have to raise a question before the PCB. It is not only the pollution part of it, it is the hydrological sustainability part of it. We should start asking why you are killing the operational efficiency of my watershed, allowing these mineral water bottle companies here. And God knows where they discharge the leftouts. okay, the wastewater, the brine. So these are the issues in our watershed, and base flows are gone. I think only in 2003 technical paper, you know, it was referred that the base flows have drastically fallen down. We need to create, my suggestion for, is it still there is a scope to sustain this watershed, come out with management practices, review the management practices which His Highness Nizam. See, today you have what is called more than 780 check dams in both the catchments, and rock fill dams, around 9,000 rock fill dams in this. And then you have farm ponds around 109. The total volume of water, these structures is going to regulate or control is 1 TMC. That is 1/3 of my reservoir. So are we studying anything on the its impact on the base flows? Is it increasing, helping the reservoir? No, we are not looking into it. We have to come out with an integrated watershed management practices. We have several international case studies. We should look into it. And then the biggest blunder that happened, maybe because of a hurry, the GO111 is partial. It only covers 150 square kilometers out of 2,000 square kilometers of the catchment. Then how do you save the watershed and the catchment? The GO111 was introduced 10 kilometer radius from the FTL to, you know, stop the Kurana's oil industries. Yes, that was a very noble cause and an objective. And unfortunately, well-known personalities were involved in drafting of the GO111. But I'm sorry to say, none of them had the knowledge and the expertise on watershed management. So it is time for us to look into strengthening GO111, extending the GO111 to the entire 2,000 square kilometers area. And conservation does not mean freezing of the development. You have umpteen number of alternate development. This is the area which can be promoted as an organic farm production center, which needs, you know, the food production, the flowers, the floriculture, horticulture, organic produce. That is a great demand in Hyderabad. Why are we forgetting about it? Forgetting this, the present government is now coming out with a shifting of Pashamylaram pharmaceutical industries to nearby Vikarabad, adjoining to Damegowda. That will be the end of this watershed story. So we have to find solutions, and we have to ask for demand for water auditing, total integrated water auditing of this basin, make this basin as a functional unit, not as a dead unit. We are only looking into the land. It has biodiversity, it has wildlife, it has floral, it has medicinal value. We are not looking into the people have the local knowledge, people have this knowledge of it. Now, from watershed of 2,000 square kilometers, we move on to the, what is this? Everybody is talking of riverfront, Musi. These were the gardens. In my childhood, I enjoyed it. There were 14 gardens, such gardens, all along the Musi, right from Puranapol. And today, we don't find any public spaces, public green spaces in this. And this is the marvelous, I tell you, Narayanakatwa, the natural flood water diversion channels. You have 17 such channels controlling the floods of Musi River. You know, this is an engineering marvel. Why we are not teaching to our children on these issues? These are most important things which I feel, and we have to look into these aspects of it. We need a watershed integrated management, looking into the contemporary issues and how do we make our watersheds functional and improve their efficiencies. I request Vishwanath, I have a video film actually. How can I show this? This is a very important video film.
So you can share the screen, sir, again.
Again? After sharing, shall I switch on?
Yes, sir.
Subbarao Garu, how long it takes for that
video? It's film? Half a minute.
Okay.
Go half ahead. A minute.
Okay, go ahead.
The domestic wastewaters and industrial wastewater join and before joining the Musi. I want to show this, you know, how the entire thing is. This is behind the HPS, our old airport, where you can see on to your right side, the jet black industrial wastewaters untreated coming. On to your left, the domestic untreated wastewaters from Kukutpally.
I'm sorry, sir, the video is not yet playing. So could you please open that video once?
Pardon?
Could you please open that video?
It's not playing. Yeah.
Okay, I will just pass on this to Vishwanath over the mobile. At the open house, he can show this. Because one can see, you know, how the untreated wastewaters is flowing into the Musi. Musi, actually, we did several studies in Musi and also with the NGT in 2015 and 16. And today, several till Edulabad and beyond the Edulabad, you cannot even grow paddy there. You cannot even grow anything there. So we are asking governments for, rehabilitation and rehabilitation of the people, restoration of these water resources through non-edible plant species. We have several plant species we are suggesting, which can control the pollution and also give them the economic strength. So we need to look into it. As rightly pointed out by Dr. Indrasena Reddy Garu, 60% of the population, they depend on this Musi, mostly the poor people, the farmers particularly. So this is the river which originates in Telangana, which is the river which joins Krishna in Telangana. Beautiful rock formations you find at Jagaipeta and other areas where you have limestone. Yeah? And people talk of Bedaghat. Forget about Bedaghat of Madhya Pradesh. Go and look at Jagaipeta and the Musi River. You find beautiful rock formations with the riverine structures. We need to save this. We need to save both the watersheds. And we should come out with a comprehensive report on a restoration of Musi River Basin. That should include the economic, ecological aspects of it, including the watersheds of Usman Sagar and Himayat Sagar. And we need to restore it back. This is 100 years it is surveying, still it is surveying. I am proud that these two reservoirs were supplying water, continue to supply water without energy. That is the biggest, and this is a historical site, yeah. I say. Gandipet and Usman Sagar and Himayat Sagar should be declared as heritage structures. We are not declaring this. So I feel, and I have the entire digitized maps and documents of this catchments and the reservoirs. So anytime, anybody who are interested to do studies, I am willing to cooperate and extend all my support. Thank you so much, Dr. Indrasena.
Thank you, Subbarao Garu. Thank you very much. It's elaborated and very, very, very important points which we earlier didn't cover when we several times discussed. Especially, you know, that these two tanks are, you know, engineering wonders. You see that how much time they took and how they planned. Now everybody appreciate, not even a single person raised any single point negative regarding these two tanks. So you can imagine, but you think about the kind of tanks which are coming up now because of these Kaleshwaram dam. before even they started that, there is a huge the opposition from the public, and it's a huge disturbance in the public in the rural areas. And as you mentioned that even I was wondering that once these tanks was filled with the Kaleshwaram water, if all of a sudden the heavy rain, the ecological issues comes up, suddenly heavy rains comes up and a huge rainfall, then all the tanks will be broken down and it will be a huge disaster. And those things and all never be, and how they are going to filling those tanks and all that, they are not even documented properly. None of the tanks are having a complete detailed project reports. It's so hurry, and I don't know the way they are taking this kind of projects and the future of the poor population, public of the Telangana. And the other thing which you mentioned is, it is really, really very serious issue that we need to strengthen the GO111, rather even nowadays they are diluting, and it is slowly, continuously diluting, and most of the political parties are directly or indirectly supporting the demand of diluting the 111 GO. And not only diluting, but they are ready to even lift. So that is another biggest task which we have on our shoulders, that we need to take a very good note on that one with the help of all you speakers like Dr. Sahabaskar and Dr. Dhanthi Narsvanedigar and yourself, and then we will proceed further. Thank you very much.
I have a small request. So whether government celebrates it or not, I think we, the members of this group, should celebrate the 100 years of these twin reservoirs. People should know that, these reservoirs are serving 100 years. Please think of this and also send a letter to the government asking to celebrate one day on these two reservoir success stories. Thank you, sir.
Yes, sure. Sure, we take it, we first send the letter to the government to celebrate these 100 years. And then once all these pandemic issues over, then we can also celebrate ourselves in our group, or taking all other groups to be considered. Thank you again, Subbarao garu.
Thank you.
And now I request Dr. Dhanthi Narasimhan Reddy garu to present his expertise on these issues. Dr. Narasimhan Reddy garu, I have a big problem of giving a note on these speakers, because I'm so small and these are very towering personalities and working decades on not only one issue or two issues, that the issue you name it of the present society that they have addressing. For example, Dr. Narasimhan Reddy garu is addressing considering issues like electricity, weavers issues, not only just touching and talking, he goes to the ground level and he prepared the document, he prepared the policy. So he is basically public policy expert. He prepares the policies and reviews also, and he works on the chemical and pesticidal issues, impacts on the farmers. Several rounds he made to the Maharashtra, and where that in several, not only one or two farmers, that more than a dozen farmers died because of that pesticidal issue not only just one village, in the several villages. He works on the genomic modified seeds also, and the natural farming, etc. These are the few only the named, and the several other issues. As I mentioned earlier, that all of these experts are working on the issues. You name the issue that they will be, ready to work on those things and all. And I now request to Dr. Dhanthi Narasimhan Reddy.
Thank you, sir. థ్యాంక్ యూ డాక్టర్ ఇంద్రసేనా రెడ్డి గారు. ఆర్ యు ఏబుల్ టు హియర్ మీ?
Yes. Please go ahead and you know, yeah, you can, you have, you know that you have 15 minutes and we have complete the entire, the webinar is we planned for 1.5 hours. So you can have a few minutes more because I gave the same thing for other speakers also. Go ahead, please.
Thank you. This is watershed area of River Musi. This was taken from a study done by International Water Management Institute. You can see at the bottommost the forest area. This depicts all the land use.
Narasimhan garu, you have some problem with your audio.
I think I was disconnected. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you. Please go ahead.
So this is the only place, you know, where you are seeing, so seeing forests. So the, you know, this is the 2002 watershed map. I think that's a long back. Now 18 years after,
some problem with your audio.
We wonder how much forest cover. So this is, of course, I was shown detail. I'm not going into those details. So, you know, one River Musi, you can see it is 11,212 square kilometer area. And it travels 267 kilometers within Telangana, starting and ends in Telangana. The important point which was alluded by Indrasena Reddy is 95 lakhs people in 2001 were residing in Musi. Now it could be easily, you know, Telangana crores in 2011 data. So almost 40%, you know, the word Musi, they will not appear. It was there before and after 6 years of Telangana formation. And second important issue is that this is the most industrialized basin. You know, almost, you know, 60-70% of industries in Telangana are located in, the government of Telangana is encouraging more industries to come up in this basin. And in fact, they are planning a big Hyderabad pharma city with 1,000 pharma industries in one cluster in a, you know, pristine area near Hyderabad airport. Despite this already intensified industrial waters from neighboring Manjira Basin, they are diverted through 18 kilometer pipeline to River Musi Basin. So we can see Musi has become a receiver of industrial domestic effluents, and it is the most intensively misused, abused river basin in Telangana. And probably, I think it tops anything in national level as well. Because most industrialization I see in Gujarat and there you don't see so much of concentration in one river. Now again, 38% of the groundwater, you know, utilizable groundwater catchment area, which was explained beautifully by Sai Bhaskar and Subbarao. So when you lose this river basin, when you are destroying the catchment area, invariably you have to depend on water coming from other river basins. And that's a promise being held by government of Telangana. They want to bring more and more water from Godavari and Pranahita through Kaleshwaram. But we have seen the disaster already striking this year. And I know Bhupnagar districts, which never ever experienced floods because of this topsy-turvy water. I mentioned 25 aniquets. You know, again and again, we need to, you know, praise the entire water system which was designed for River Musi long back. I think those 25 aniquets, you know, through gravity, you know, they don't, it's not, you know, lift irrigation and does not use energy, and it is a zero cost water storage facility, unlike Kaleshwaram, which has, you know, every year it will be 6,000 crore maintenance system. So 25 villages for the past 100 years, 40,000 hectares of agriculture and drinking water needs were fulfilled by these 25 aniquets or katwas, apart from the twin lakes which we have been discussing. So I think the beauty of this entire water system, apart from the natural water cycles which we have been discussing, I think this man-made and ecologically friendly system, I think that we need to recognize. But then we are moving towards water stress. And as I mentioned, increasingly the population load is increasing, and we are only making it a linear management. So we are polluting the water and increasingly bringing water from outside. So I think all this together, and then the watershed destruction, which was explained earlier, water stress, I think that's a major problem which we have to recognize. And then the low water use efficiency. 35 to 40% is unnecessarily wasted. You know, in Hyderabad urban area, 40% is unaccounted water, I mean the supplied water by Metro Water Works. And then the other groundwater which is pumped by apartments and many other places, almost 35% is inefficiently used. I think so we have to flag this as well. Now just a small brief on these twin lakes. Usman Sagar was built in 1920 on River Musi. So they, we are in the 100th year, and that's a big celebration. We have, it's not just, this is not the just old one. Himayat, Hussain Sagar, of course, is 400 years old. And I think Miralam tank, there are many other tanks which are as old and as big and bigger than Usman Sagar. And the catchment area, recorded catchment area in Nizam, you know, at that time, Gadget, is 739 square kilometers for Usman Sagar, and Himayat Sagar, it is 689 square kilometers. And these two became dry for the first time in 2003. That is, I think, almost after 80 years of their existence. That speaks volumes of the this small time, 30 years time, we have been successfully able to destroy them. Now I'll come to the GOs, you know, the protection GOs. We discuss mostly GO 111, but there are other GOs which were there before as well. So in 1989, there was a GO which tried to protect the hydrological region. So what we are talking about, B.V. Subbarao has been emphasizing is the entire hydrological regime needs to be protected, while GO 111 talks of only 10 kilometer radius and at least 150 square kilometer area. But GO 50 is much wider. And you know, in 1994. In fact, before 111, there was this 192 GO which tried to protect this area from polluting industries, hotels, residential colonies, and other establishments. And GO 111 came in 19, was a technical committee formed in 2005. But in between, after 96, I think Surana company tried to establish industry within 10 kilometer radius. And the case went up to Supreme Court. Supreme Court again emphasized the sanctity of GO 111. Because it went through, you know, it was not an easy judgment. Three surveys were done, three reports were given, and after a long discussion, I think the Supreme Court upheld GO 111. So it's not easy. And again, after 2005, 2008 also, 2009, sorry, our own High Court also, you know, upheld this GO. So there are number, but then exemptions continue. So the culprit is not just the Telangana government. Even previous governments in the last 15-20 years have been continuously diluting GO 111, and also the catchment area destruction process started long back. So you can see a number of institutes have come up, engineering colleges have come up. Now SCZs are also being established in this catchment area. So I think there are multitude of problems, and one important aspect which was raised and which was established by a study is between 1961-96, 36 year period, a study found that these two twin lakes, water bodies, were full 10 times Husman Sagar and 11 times Himayat Sagar in first 18 years. But next 18 years, it decreased. So, and study estimated that Himayat Sagar would be completely dry in 2036 and Husman Sagar in 2040. But we have reached that stage, I think almost 15-20 years earlier. So both the lakes are now becoming dry, and if we don't do any action, I think government and the real estate industry will be happy to decimate these two lakes in the next 1 year. We are not looking at something further. So as I said, Supreme Court judgment in 2000 was also very severe on this. But then again, it was mentioned 40 million gallons per hour through gravity flow. Again, there was no pumping, and the cost of supply was only 2 rupees to 3 rupees kiloliter. But if you take the Nagarjuna Sagar, it costs 50 rupees per kiloliter because it comes from almost 140 kilometers and up by 600 feet. And now Godavari, I think it is almost reaching 100 rupees per kiloliter or more because of the investment done. So we are increasing the cost, energy, and then the destruction process is happening. So when we are destroying the two lakes, it is not just the physical destruction. We are loading ourselves with the costs for generations to come. I think that is a very significant problem. And if you look at the international airport, many of you think out of 5,000 acres of the international airport, 2,000 acres is coming under Himayat Sagar catchment area. High Court also says, but ultimately it cleared the project. So the major culprits, you know, I would say their master plans. If you look at the Hyderabad master plan, we have at least 7 to 8 master plans. The latest one being in 2012. I think even in 2012, the master plan does not recognize this water bodies. Essential for has distorted the entire geography, Kokapet, you know, all these areas, and they are getting exemptions. So I think these three are the major causes which are causing problem. I'll come to river Musi. Of course, excuse pollution me. Is a big, big problem.
నర్సింహరెడ్డి గారు మీ మీ స్పీకర్ ఇస్ సమ్ ప్రాబ్లం, మీరు కొంచెం దాన్ని డిస్టర్బ్ చేస్తున్నట్టు ఉన్నారు. మైక్రోఫోన్ డిస్టర్బ్.
ఇట్ ఇస్
ఓకే, ప్లీజ్ గో అహెడ్.
ఓకే, నౌ ఇట్ ఇస్ ఓకే.
యా,
సో రివర్ పొల్యూషన్, యు నో, అగైన్ దిస్ వాస్ ఎస్టిమేట్ డన్ అ ఫ్యూ ఇయర్స్ బ్యాక్. ఎవ్రీ డే 900 million liters of sewerage joins river Musi. And you know, as I said earlier, those 40,000 hectares which they felt is 25 katwas were a boon, and now it has become a bane. It has become a shapam. It is a Telugu we say oka varamu shapanga marina paristhiti ikkada kanapadutundi. 25 katwas, those 25 katwas which were built to supply and sustain water storage capacities in at least 25 villages and for 40,000 hectares, now it has become a curse, because all this 40,000 hectares is receiving completely polluted water. Studies have been done by National Institute of Nutrition, Institute of Preventive Medicine. They have recorded, I think, number of engineering colleges students also have done studies. You can see that groundwater with heavy metals, arsenic, fluoride, iron, lead, you know, that kind of highly toxic pollution is happening. And 25% of the pollution is coming from industries. And as I said, part of it is also coming from Manjira diversion pipeline. So Patancheru and all those areas, Jeedimetla industrial area. So the all pharma industries, steel re-rolling industries, chemical industries, all of them are contributing to river Musi pollution. Now there are solutions, you know, government, what government is trying to look at. Government long back in 1999-2000, they proposed a Nandanavanam beautification project. The proposal was to reduce river Musi to a 9-meter channel, and then on either side build roads and collect the funds for this project by selling the land on the either side of Musi for real estate purposes. So there was a big movement, Musi Bachao Andolan, Chhetri was established under that. So I was part of all those efforts, and we went to the High Court also, but High Court struck it down saying this is development. So they said reduction of a natural river is development. At that time, that was a stand taken by High Court. And then the encroachment drive, anti-encroachment drives stopped long back, almost 20 years back. Current municipal administration minister, 3 years back, he said, can anyone, you know, he dared every politician, can anyone take action against encroachments? He said politically it's impossible, openly. I have that statement. So this is the current municipal administration minister saying, who is supposed to be, you know, built an image for himself that he has no nonsense a minister. So encroachments have reduced the river Musi at several places, and at Chadargat you can see almost 60% of the space is gone. Sewerage treatment plants have been proposed for long. You can see the list on the right side, 17, and most of them are supported by central government, but none of them are working except a few. And Amberpet, the biggest sewerage treatment plant, it's a mere plant, and it does not even treat. And whatever the rudimentary treatment which happens, they let it out into River Musi. So the point is, we don't understand the need for recycling water. I don't know when we will understand that. Unless we do that, what Singapore is doing, what America is doing, what Israel is doing, we are not doing that. I think we need to do that clearly. And then the latest threat to Musi is the strategic road development plan. Number of flyovers, interchange have been planned. They have established a Musi road, Hyderabad Road Construction Corporation, and then the Musi Corporation as well, headed by MLA. Now, currently, Sudhir Reddy is heading that. And this corporation, I think, is being used to push forward the SRDP plans, which are not in the public domain. Whatever little came out 2 years back, now we can't even see that. So there is no public consultation, there is no public information, there is no transparency. And yet, I know government says we want to develop Musi on the lines of some other western river. But if you look at River Nasik, on River Godavari at Nasik, they did some complete concretization in the name of Godavari beautification. But when civil society protested and High Court intervened, now they have restored the River Godavari Nasik. I think that's a good case study which we need to follow. And also in Manila, there is one river which they restored completely, which is much more polluting than River Musi, but they have restored it with political will. I think that is what is required here. Now, these are the features again. Musi flows through six districts, currently six districts, but there is no single authority. You can see GHMC, Hyderabad Water Board, HMDA, Kuli Kutub Shah Urban Development Authority, Cyberabad Development Authority, all of these deal with construction development in River Musi Basin, but none of them show any responsibility towards that. And there are other stakeholders. So water is a state subject, but government does not include the people in people into confidence. So I'm just rushing because I think time is a major constraint. Finally, I think what about the solutions? As Subbarauji said and Sai Bhaskar mentioned, we need to look at river basin management, not just 20 kilometers a stretch and then say we are beautifying this. And we need a Musi River Basin Authority, which can be brought into a statutory act in the legislature or parliament. I think the central government role is also very, very important here. And this authority, through this authority, we need a Musi River Basin Development Plan, and where sustainable development goals can be developed and targets and the indicators can be developed. And this river basin map needs to be developed and monitored continuously. Importantly, we need a restoration of Musi River dimension, which is being encroached continuously. We need the scientific assessment of sewerage inflows and outflows. So I'll stop here because I think through discussions we can have more points emerging. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Narasimha Reddy garu. It gives కొంచెం ఆడ్ అనిపిస్తుంది నరసింహారెడ్డి గారు డాక్టర్ నరసింహారెడ్డి గారు అనడం బికాస్ వి కాల్ హిమ్ ఆల్వేస్ జస్ట్ నర్సన్న నర్సన్న ఇంక్లూడింగ్ హిస్ బాస్ హిస్ గురు ప్రొఫెసర్ పురుషోత్తమ్ రెడ్డి గారు యా యాజ్ యూ మెన్షన్ దట్ నాట్ ఓన్లీ జస్ట్ 6-11 దెర్ ఆర్ సెవెరల్ అదర్ ప్రీవియస్ జీవోస్ అండ్ అదర్ ఆల్ ద జీవోస్ నీడ్ టు బి బ్రింగ్ అవుట్ అండ్ వీ నీడ్ టు మేక్ ఎ బిగ్ అండ్ వెరీ వెరీ a strong file by considering all the speakers which you know the irregular real estate what Dr. Sai Bhaskar Reddy mentioned and Subbarao garu mentioned and is also you are mentioned about several things and especially the river Musi Basin Authority has to be established not a, you know 1 kilometer 2 kilometer it's like a puja kind of thing no the entire thing starting catchment area of that both the lake both the tanks and the Musi and the rest of the down to until the Vadapalli where it joins in the Krishna river so the entire thing has to be you know made a clear the document and we need to take into consideration and fight with the as you mentioned, not just with the state government, and we need to bring it into the issue to the central government. As I in the beginning, I mentioned that this is the only the you know webinar which we started you know within the city, and we will have a more of other urban issues on the different districts and all state level webinar and also national level, and we have a few people who had. Experience of addressing and resolving and restoring these kind of issues in international level as well that we will go to that extent you know before we make a very very good draft on these issues and submit to the government thank you very much Narasanna and now I request Professor Purushottam Reddy garu because we keep him last so whenever we miss the things and all that he covers and also that all the people will remain seated if it is indoor now it is in a webinar will remain until Professor Purushottam Reddy garu completes his talk so again I mention here that you know it's a huge thing that if you know mention about what his credentials is that but I cannot excuse myself without mentioning very few things but most of our you know audience are known about him and if anybody one or two not knowing about anything you know we can just google it that everything bunch of things comes up but I will mention few things and you know not only just you know direct environmental issues which he handled that more than 50 cases he filed only just in a Pattancheru area and then he got the judgment as well unfortunately few of them were implemented and many of them were not implemented because of our you know lazy and you know very thick skin governments which are functioning not only this one but earlier ones because of that you know it has not resulted as he expected though he fought and got the judgments and all he also fought that you know not only just water issues in the Nalgonda and fluoride issues in the Nalgonda and also uranium project Nagarjun Sagar and you can every 3 months or 4 months or one or the other issue he handles that around cities there we have a several dumping yard problems and recently in the Nallamala there is another you know that uranium issue he is involved and it worked well for the betterment of the people living there so he is continuously struggling in the you know fighting against these government policies which are having the problem creating the problem to the public since last more than 3 decades and all so I request now Professor Purushottam Reddy garu to speak
Thank you very much, Dr. Indra Sena Reddy. I have, after excellent presentations from Dr. Sai Bhaskar Reddy, my senior in the subject, B.V. Subbarao Garu, Dr. Narasimha Reddy, and you yourself, Dr. Indra Sena Reddy. Between the four of you, a major portion of almost the entire subject is covered. I wish to add only a few or remind a few things which have already happened. Recently, we have been sensitizing the law college students, right from Symbiosis Law School, then Padarla Ram Reddy, Pendekanti, and Sultanulu Nalsar. We have been giving lectures, sensitizing them, motivating them. And quite a few of these students have started filing cases. So with regards to the garbage dump yards, it was Symbiosis. And then when it comes to Moosi, of course, Dr. Indra Sena Reddy himself filed several petitions in the NGT. But in addition to him, Padmanabh Reddy Garu, but lot of activists have been filing cases. Even the students of Sultan Ulum College, they have filed cases in the NGT, and we got excellent orders. In addition to these, recently there was a major issue in the catchment area of Moosi. And whenever I am speaking about Moosi, it includes ESA. ESA is a tributary of Moosi. And the origin, the source of the river is near Vikarabad, on that area, the entire forest area, including a place known as Dhamagundam. Both the government of India and the government of Telangana, they have recently allotted approximately 3,000 acres of this prime forest area to Indian Navy, and they wanted to go in for installation of a defense facility. Of course, we took up that issue because the source of the river is very, very important. A river without the source being protected, the river will die. And as it is, Moosi is virtually non-existing right now. But that means if Dhamagundam is allowed to come, then that means the end of the Moosi itself. So we took up that issue, and thanks to young advocate Spandana, we were able to file the case in the Andhra Pradesh, in Telangana High Court, and we got a stay right now. Now, coming to the subject, which I don't want to do a lot of repetition, but just to remind, please, it's important that we realize that Moosi is not a drain. Moosi has compulsorily to flow. It's a river, and being a river, it has to flow. Because once it begins to flow, then automatically self-purifying capabilities of the river are very well known, and that will be very beneficial. Then the river must have a space to flow. We call it Moosi must have space, particularly as and how it enters the city of Hyderabad. We have to ensure that there is abundant space. Moosi is an ecological system in itself, but then it is part of a larger ecological system, that is the River Krishna Basin. All these points we take into consideration. We have to ensure that there is a minimum flow in the river. We also need to ensure that there is an environmental flow. And these flows are very important to maintain the river regime. Whenever water from a river is used, and then that wastewater invariably gets into the river system. And particularly in the context of Moosi, it is mostly urban, that is Hyderabad and the periphery. In addition to this, we have a lot of industries, and Hyderabad is the pharma capital of India. Almost all the leading companies are here, and their only job is to pollute and pollute and nothing else. they have succeeded in destroying the river system. We have excellent laws. I'm not going into all the details, but the Prevention of Water Pollution Act is very important, 1974. And Pollution Control Boards, which came into being in 1976, they have been working very hard to destroy the river by itself, completely. Their arrogance, indifference, dereliction of duty, you know, we need to note. And they have destroyed the groundwater. They have made the lives of the people, not just in Pattancheru, wherever the industries are, people have been destroyed. And they continue to destroy. And finally, they have killed the river Mosi. Now coming to, in addition to PCB, we have the GHMC, HMDA, who are totally ignorant of the need to protect the river. In fact, there are excellent books that are now available worldwide. And one of the best book is Design with Nature. If only our HMDA people and GHMC people, you know, the mayor and all the 150 corporators, if they go through this emerging global literature, and if they have the political will, they can still do something, but they are not the kind of stuff to read the books, and therefore the problem persists. My friend Dr. Narasimha Reddy wonderfully predicted and demanded that there should be a political will. But I wish to point out that citizens' will invariably precedes political will. The question is, we the people living in this part of India, are we determined, if we don't have the right will to protect Mosi, politicians will not, they will not take upon themselves. Political will not be there. So citizens' will is the most important thing. And this webinar being organized by Save Rivers, Dr. Indra Sena Reddy, and supported by Sai Bhaskar, Dr. Sai Bhaskar and Dr. Subba Rao Garu. And so many eminent people have joined in this discussion. I'm sure in the days to come, this citizens will manifest in some form or the other, and it has to be very serious because it's a question of life and death. Now, what are the options? The options, just to recall, we can all be demanding that the orders of the Supreme Court and the High Court, NGT, etc., all those orders, we can make a list of all the orders and demand the compliance of these orders. This is very important. In fact, we can straight away, we need to send the Chief Secretary to the jail for not implementing the orders. I don't understand how the bureaucracy seem to think that they are above the Constitution. I mean, what is the role of the Chief Secretary? Is he above the Supreme Court of India? How dare he not implement the orders? It's a very serious offense. And we, the citizens, we need to take this up. Yes, we need to file contempt cases. But in addition to this, can we do something in view of the approaching GHMC elections? Yes, we have to go to the people. We have to highlight these issues. If necessary, these issues should become very vocal during the time of elections, and we should demand the citizens of Hyderabad, the people living in this part, including the catchment area, the entire Mosi basin, yes, because their right to livelihood is affected. The farmers downstream of Adilabad, or even from Ambarpet onwards, you know, because the water is contaminated, polluted, poisoned, it has affected their right to life, right to health. And definitely they have to, you know, be vocal. In a democracy, eternal vigilance is the price we need to pay. And we need to be vigilant. Environmental issues are not time pass issues. And again, please, these are life and death issues, and we need to take it in that spirit. Friends, as we go into the future, we have to come up with status reports, and we need to knock the doors of justice. We have to be very active. So far, whatever we have been doing, it is not adequate, and it is not resulting in positive results. Recently, I had the opportunity of going to Damagundam area when we took up that issue, and that is a virgin forest. They are about to cut it and destroy. Already allotted, and the Navy has paid a token amount for alternative forestation. And the Forest Department was very happy to hand it over to the Navy. I don't know how they can consider this to be development. So, this, as rightly pointed out by the previous speakers, right from Sai Bhaskar, Subbarao Garu, and Narasimha Reddy, these are very important issues. After this webinar, definitely I request Dr. Indrasena Reddy, because he himself is an activist of a very serious type. Right now he is in USA, but he is working even from there. And let us make it a national issue. Yes, let us knock the doors of the Supreme Court if necessary. NGT, whatever is needed, we need to do. And law colleges, the students are waiting. And if necessary, we need to ensure it is not just a celebration of 100 years of Usman Sagar. The people of Hyderabad must observe a day for the River Musi. And on that day, they have to observe a bandh. Bandh is a, you know, it indicates the citizens' will to protect the river. A bandh is a very peaceful, non-violent, method, and recalling the great services of the Indian freedom struggle and Mahatma Gandhi. Let us, yes, we need to go in for civil disobedience. We have to use the weapon of satyagraha if we are serious. Otherwise, time pass, we can have any number of webinars. That's a different thing. But if we are very serious, yes, let us all come together. And it is not just a saving, because Musi is already dead. Let us, now what is it that we can do? All our rulers, all the institutions like PCB, the state government, central government, and the other local bodies, GHMC, HMDA, they have all succeeded, in killing the river. And we the people, even we have failed the river. Because protection of environment is our duty as well. And we have not done our duty. At least let us do our duty now. And let us give a bandh call. And before that, we need to sensitize. Right now, there is corona. We can't go to the colleges and the universities. But definitely through webinars. And somehow, we have to express our displeasure, our seriousness about the protection of the river. I'm sure in the days to come, we'll find something. I thank Dr. Indrasena Reddy Garu for organizing this, because he has been at it for the last 5 years or even more. And I'm sure in the days to come, every one of us will come together and learn to make a common cause for the common future of humanity in this part. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. So, I think it was a very, very well crafted slides and well drafted comment. And I think if I make any kind of summarizing of these things, it will be diluted. But nevertheless, few points I will highlight, and then we'll go for a few questions from the audience. Certainly, as I mentioned in the beginning, that it's not just conducting a webinar and forgetting that we are taking all the opinions since a long time. Not only this time, as I mentioned again in the earlier, since last 3-4 years we are working on the Musi, and Yeah, these points, like for example, Sai Bhaskar mentioned that about the because of the zigzag and unwanted and unplanned, the kind of real estate is spoiling the water bodies and catchment areas in the outskirts of the city and the catchment area of these two tanks. That has to be seriously taken. And then Dr. Naswar Reddy Garu mentioned that this Musi River is became a receiver of all, not only just a municipal wastage, the industrial wastage, medical wastage, now even electronic wastage also I can see in some of the parts of the Musi. It has become a dump yard. As earlier, long back, Professor Pushpendra Reddy mentioned that it is not polluted, it is poisoned. But still, our authorities or the politicians are not waking up until it has become a big disaster. And as he also mentioned that they are waiting to be happen a big disaster. So then that has become a serious issue. And, you know, Dr. Narasimhan Reddy Garu mentioned that about the lakes, we have to consider not only the 300 plus lakes which are there within the city, for the, you know, for the carbon sink or for the better environment or better present livable to make a livable city. Even around the city, there are several lakes which, you know, directly or indirectly linked to the Musi. There are more than 300 lakes around the Hyderabad city. So probably we need to consider all this area and the water bodies, especially that Subbarao Garu mentioned that these dams and these rivers reflects of these water bodies. You know, without having any proper water bodies, there is no lakes, no rivers, nothing. So we need to consider a serious concentration on the water bodies around within the city and around the city, and include in the report that what we make it. And I will certainly, Professor Sir, you mentioned that we will take it very serious, that we will make sure that the Chief Secretary will, you know, get up from his chair and will work on this, like the kind of, he is the person who is the responsible for the implementing the judicial orders. If the government is not obeying the and implementing the judicial orders, then a small people like us, then we don't need to care about the rules and regulations what framed by government and ruling. So that that seriously we will to all the orders we need to take one by one, and then we'll force on the government, and we'll explore, actually we expose the government that kind of work it is doing. For example, NGT ordered the government that, you know, find out the 3 or 4 places, each 200 to 300 acres, and these Jawahar Nagar dump yard should be the, you know, separated. Entire the city wastage is going to only Jawahar Nagar. And NGT asked them, they gave an order that it has to be separated for 3 to 4 places, and that has to be done within the 3 to 4 months. And even NGT asked the government to update the kind of steps is taking to implement the orders. But until now, not even 1% of the work has been done. Unfortunately, the courts give the judgments, but they don't have a mechanism, as Professor Purushottam Reddy Garu mentioned, that they don't have any mechanism to see the implementation of their orders. They just give the orders, that's all. So it is our responsibility again that we enforce the government to comply these orders. So that also we will take the very serious. And finally, that these arrogance of these some of the organizations like pollution control boards, they became like ornaments for the government. They're making, you know, how anybody can imagine that a 20 people of a organization with the 20 people, PCB having around 20 scientists, and how can they look after more than 2,000 companies in the city? They are only just there to collecting the funds, and that's all. There's nothing that, and the central government has the policy that they only the taking, they see the, you know, work, paperwork, and they give the permission, the environmental permission, and the implementation of that, you know, document by the companies has to be taken care by the local PCB. But the local PCB is not capable of doing that job. And ultimately, you know that the kind of cities we are seeing, that Hyderabad kind of cities are coming up in not only just in our state, but in other states also, the same kind of cities. If you go to the Gujarat or the Maharashtra or even Chhattisgarh kind of states, the all the companies, you know, generating a huge amount of pollution and spoiling the environment, just only not only water bodies but the entire the soil, and making a big hell for the living of the people. So earlier it used to be like a, you know, roti kapda makan, but now these days we need to forget about those things. Anyway, the government is not taking care of that one, but they have to take care of the, you know, livable place. They need to keep these cities and the states and the entire the country for the livable. For that, in that direction, we need to work the best possible. So with this, there is one question is came that somebody was asking about the when the Musi book on Musi is coming up. We are working on this probably sometime the second quarter of next year, maybe in the March, April, this will come. And but we won't release until this COVID problem completes. Once COVID completes, that we wanted to make it that the releasing of this book in Hyderabad city should have a more launching, you know, the agitation for this environmental issue on the, especially the Musi and the other problems. So from there, not only just releasing the book, and we are also planning to have a video and audio CDs, songs on these environmental issues, and especially on the Musi. We launch that also on the same occasion when the book is releasing. So that's why we are waiting for these, you know, the COVID problem to be resolved, and then we will conduct that book release function. So thank you very much for all the speakers, and it's a very excellent, really, it's not just a formal sake I'm mentioning that, it is a really, really is a very excellent, you know, information that you put, we have recorded and we made it a document also.
Are you allowing any question?
Yes. Now I can see that if anybody want to ask any question, you can raise the hand. Yashwant, can you unmute everybody so that if whoever wanted to ask the question, they can.
No, they can raise their hand. There is a provision to raise their hand.
But I can't see your hand then, because you are not in the picture.
Raise their hand, sir. We can unmute them.
Okay. But it's a 2 pages. You know, I can't see the others if they raise the hand. In my laptop screen, I can see only 1 page, but we were 27 people in distributed in 2 pages.
Are unmute the Yashwant? Under unmute the local.
Suprasanna garu, hi. You want to say something? You need to unmute. Yashwant, can you?
Hi. They can unmute.
Good afternoon to everyone. I, being in the same line, could gather so much of information from your talk. All the 4 speakers, whosoever has spoken, has given so abundant of information on this Musi River. We have been hearing here and there the peripherals kind of a talk, not this specific and very clearly and clarity way of how the source is coming and how the way it is going and the kind of the pollution that is happening and the kind of the action we need to understand on this. It's fantastic, sir. Hardly in the recent past, this kind of a webinar I have not come across. It's really very specific and focused, and we really need to get into the action mode at this juncture. That's number one. I understand that, you know, it can be used, to what extent the technologies can be used here in understanding this kind of a pollution, pollutants at every place. We have got at, somebody said that, you know, the nalas and the kind of the tunnels or the culverts and this and that, everywhere, you know, if we put up certain kind of a technological instrumentation, then really we can catch the real culprit areas for the polluting water I'm talking about. And the other kind of inflow and self-cleaning flow and all that is a real big issues because of the real estate gummit that is happening. So that in that orientation, if something can be thought of, it is really a big way that we can protect this. That's what I have for. Not really a question, a kind of information that I am being in the field and I'm talking about. Thank you very much for giving this opportunity.
Sure. Yashwant, can you run that the radio, audio,
yes,
the video?
Yes, sir. Okay. I will do it.
Go ahead. And this is the one which Subbarao Garu tried to play it, but he couldn't make it.
Is it visible, sir?
Yeah.
Please watch carefully. You see the jet black color of the industrial waste waters and domestic gray waters, you know, coming from Kukutpally on the left, and the right one is from Balanagar and Jidimetla jet black. Both join behind the old airport before joining the Hussain Sagar. In 2015, government claimed that it's going to divert the jet black industrial wastewaters and directly put it in the Hussain Sagar. The case was filed in NGT and government spent 52 crores claiming that they will divert and separate these two channels. It did not happen, but 52 crores of public money ran into the thin air. This is the present situation where everything gets mixed up before joining the MOSI. Thank you so much.
Can I add one more information to this, please?
Yeah, sure.
See, as we understand that, you know, the storage capacity of the twin reservoirs plus the tank burn, it can amount to some about, you know, 3.9 and 2.9 and 1 about 6 and 7, about 7 to 8 TMCs, which can take to about, you know, 100 days of water requirement to our city. Suppose when I say one Himayat Sagar, it is taking about 30 days of water requirement, Usman Sagar 40 days of water requirement, and the tank bund can take about 10 days of water requirement. Like this, about 100 days of water requirement can be really have here itself. We are spoiling that waters and then, you know, trying to get everything from the Krishna and the Godavari, whereby, you know, to the exchequer, it is a heavy, huge cost, and that cost is going to be on us and to the future generation. So by protecting this, we have our own way of having the waters within the city itself. That's number one. Number two is that by doing, getting up to the recycling level for the water consumption within ourselves, that can further add up in on another 50 days. The 50% of the water, recycling water or the water consumption can be just like that used for the recycling. So 150 days, to the extent of 150 days, the water can be within the city, what is used and what is recycled, that can happen if provided we really fight out for this reservoir's protection in a true manner. So this is what is the benefit we can get. About a half of the year, you know, we can have here, apart from the rainwater, other kind of a water recharge kind of a things. So I'm talking about the domestic water consumption and how we can save with the availability, natural available facilities, whatever we have right now. That's the point I wanted to convey.
Yeah, thank you, Suprasen Reddy garu. Right in 2001, this point was raised before the government. I myself made a presentation on this strategic approaches in water conservation, and also, you know, extending the water supply systems, actually. So I can share this with you. And for your kind information, these two reservoirs, they cater to the needs of something like 4 lakh households even to this day. Okay, you have the well-connected pipelines and everything. And you can also have this after this webinar, you know, if you are interested to know the exact water supply systems of these reservoirs, where people like you can intervene, actually. Thank you.
I shall get in touch with you, sir, on this.
Okay. Anybody has any question? Shall we conclude, Dr. Narasimha Reddy?
Hello.
I think, yeah.
Yeah, I think we can close that. If there are no questions, we can.
Yeah. Thank you very much, all of the speakers, and Dr. Sai Bhaskar Reddy, Dr. Subbarao Garu, and Dr. Narasimha Reddy, and Professor Purushottam Reddy Garu, and all the audience. Thank you very much for your patience and attending this webinar. And I'm sure that we will have about in 2 weeks, then we will have a national level webinar on the same issue, same topics. But the other issues also in, you know, we have other same kind of problems in other part of the country. Then we consider those issues, including the Musi and these water bodies. And we'll have a national level webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you.